Hello, my name is Jonathan Clark, also known as DJ Bolivia. Welcome to tutorial number 6 in my series about audio recording. Now, if you've watched the first 5 tutorials, well, actually, if you haven't, here's a link to them. Anyway, if you have watched the first 5 tutorials, you've probably noticed that most of them are very practical, hands-on. Basically, I've tried to teach you a little bit about sound, a little bit about how to record a signal and get it into the computer, whether it's through the use of a microphone or using cords coming out of your instruments, your musical equipment. And I've talked a little bit about basic editing in a computer software package and how to process the audio that way. So what I've taught you so far basically is the building blocks of what you need to know for audio recording. Now, one kind of major topic I haven't talked about yet is the use of MIDI, which I'll do in the next video. That's kind of important. But other than that, I've covered most of the basics that you'll need to know, okay? Very bold statement. And obviously everything that I've taught you so far, we could go into 100 times more detail about. And you'll start refining the basic techniques that I've already taught you in upcoming videos and whatnot, but at least you've got a background. So I wanted to kind of switch gears today and get into some theory instead. Because you, obviously, if you're watching these videos, no one's forcing you to watch them. So if you are watching them and you've gotten this far, it shows me that you are definitely interested in learning how to do this and presumably learning how to do it well. Now, the drawback is that theory is kind of boring, but, well, not to everyone, but when you start to learn some of the theory that I'm going to teach you here, you can actually apply it to your work processes, and so it can make things more efficient, the way you do things, and eventually it'll make your productions, your recordings, sound better. So it's kind of important. Now, some of the stuff I'm going to talk about in this video is kind of detailed in terms of math and science, technology. If math, if you weren't a fan of math in school, don't be scared of this. Yes, I'm going to be getting into some stuff here for a few minutes, 10 minutes maybe, that will be a little bit confusing. The good thing is, if you don't fully understand it, it's probably okay, because I'm going to try to explain the background and then bring in some broad analogies, which hopefully will let you make sense of the concepts. So at the end of the video, if you don't remember the math, it may be fine. As long as you understand the concepts that I was trying to get across, then that's cool. And I mean, if you really want to go further, if you think after watching this that you'd like to watch it a second time, and a little bit more will sink in, you'll finally get a good feeling about it all, you may not necessarily need to do that. It may be better for you to watch this once now and then go back to playing with, you know, hands-on projects for a couple weeks. And then later, once you've done some more projects, you'll probably see little references while you're doing the projects, sample rates, all that sort of stuff, and things will start to click. And then if you came back in 2, 3, 4 weeks and watched this a second time, I think things would click a little bit better, okay? So you may want to watch this a few times until it all sinks in. But I'm not saying that you have to understand this all right now before we go on to a video number 7 or video 8. This is key stuff. Unfortunately, recording, you know, doing recording sessions, being a good audio engineer means you do have to understand some scientific stuff here, okay? But I will try to make it as easy as possible here. So what I'm going to talk about today are some broad concepts like sampling. Now let me talk about sampling. What most people think of as sampling in terms of audio is the process of taking a small sound from, say, another song or a recording of nature or something like that. And so it's basically just a snippet of audio that you record. And then you'll put that sample that snippet of audio into one of your own songs. Maybe manipulate a little bit, change it around, or maybe just use it the way it was. That is not the kind of sampling I'm going to be talking about today. That type of sampling is important in music. It depends. I mean, maybe it's not really important in classical music. But in electronica, in hip-hop, you know, that sort of stuff, sampling is used pretty often. The sampling I'm going to talk about today instead relates to how digital recordings are made. Normally, there's, well, for years, when people started to record music, computers didn't exist, so there was no such thing as digital audio. All there was analog, is what it was called. So let me quickly tell you how analog audio can be recorded. One example, common, would be magnetic tape. So with tape, what you have is you have the tape itself, which is, it's probably something like Mylar or something like that, okay? And nothing's actually recorded on the tape. You know, when I was growing up, I used to think cassette tapes, that little strip of tape, there must be some sort of little pen or something that scratched out a little pattern on the tape that the machine would read and that would play back a sound. It's not how it works at all. All the tape is something to hold stuff together. Okay, on top of the tape, there's a glue, a layer of glue, an adhesive, bonding agent. Okay, on top of the glue, or embedded in the glue, is what really matters, the magnetic particles. Okay, and so these magnetic particles can be made of different sort of things. Iron oxide was common, FeO. Chromium dioxide, CrO2, was common. And basically any small particles that can be magnetized can kind of work on tape. And so what happens is, you have a microphone or something like that generating, recording a sound, recording an audio source, microphone converts the sound energy into an electrical pattern. That's pretty basic. And what happens is that electrical pattern goes to the record head on the tape recorder, and this magnetic tape passes over the record head slowly, and as it does, the electrical signal changes the magnetic field right there. And so basically the magnetic orientation of the particles on the tape changes. And it changes permanently, unless you mess up the tape. Okay, so later, somebody goes to play back the tape, and the exact opposite process happens. You've got a playhead there. The tape once again passes over the playhead at hopefully exactly the same speed. And as it passes over, reverse process, the magnetic fields are read, converted back into a signal, goes out to your speakers. That's a gross simplification, but that's essentially how magnetic tape works. So what happens is, that's kind of a constant signal. Now, eventually computers were invented, and people realized, well, we want to be able to store stuff. And so numbers, information was stored in the computers using computer memory, using RAM, whatever, or digital storage, and the information had to be recorded as a series of, I should say symbols, really, I mean, we say it's recorded as a stream of numbers, but really, it's symbolic. So what happens is, to record the sound, because you can't put the piece of tape into the computer, the sound or audio had to be converted somehow to a stream of numbers that other devices could then read back and then convert back to sound at the other end. Okay, so how does a computer change a sound into a digital stream of information? Well, what it does is it just keeps taking measurements over and over and over. And so at, you know, basically it'll take a slice. And so it's not recording, when it records a sample, it's not recording the audio, it's recording measurements. So when someone says it samples the audio, it just takes a measurement. How loud is the audio at that point? What's the frequency of the audio at that point? Okay, so it just keeps taking that measurement over and over and then stores that information in the computer. So that's what digital audio is. So knowing that, we really need to get an understanding of binary to figure out how this information is recorded. How exactly are these samples taken, and what can affect the quality of the audio that comes out? Okay, so I'll talk about that in a minute. Now, there's a few other things that I could talk about here today, but I'm going to save some of these for an advanced theory video. But basically, things that are related to the sample rate and frequency would be things like the Nyquist theorem. And just to give you a very brief overview, the Nyquist theorem, it's named after this guy, Nyquist, scientist. He wasn't even the first person that figured this out. He just happened to be lucky and got his name attached to it. But anyway, his theorem says that in order to make a good sounding replication of a sound by sampling, your frequency of samples has to be at least double the frequency of the sound. Okay, so let's say you've got a tuning fork playing at concert A, 440 hertz, okay? If you want to have a good digital recording of that tuning fork, you have to have your sample frequency at least double that of the pitch of the fork, which means at least 880 hertz sample rate. Okay, that's all I'm going to explain about that for now. We'll go into that theory in more depth in another video. Okay, so that's one thing that's important. Now, I could also talk about things like aliasing. Aliasing is basically, it's a type of distortion, imperfection in a signal at certain frequencies. And anti-aliasing means how you deal with getting rid of that. Okay, so that's something we'll talk about in a future video. We'll eventually talk about quantization noise, and that's when your accuracy of your samples, you get a little bit of error because you can't be as accurate as you'd like, and so that's quantization noise. We'll talk about how to deal with that. And dithering. Dithering is a process where you artificially introduce a little bit of noise into your audio, to ironically make it sound better. Okay, so dithering is something we'll talk about in a future video. But these things are all important ways of making sure that your audio projects sound good, and they're all related to your sample rate and your frequency. Okay, so let's get the pain over with. Let's talk about binary first. Okay, let me give you the best possible explanation of binary and how it works and why it's important in the next, I'd like to say 5 minutes, which of course means it'll probably take me 10 to explain. Like I say, some of this will be pretty abstract and you might find it, you might wonder if you really need this. Hopefully at least you get the concepts out of this. Okay, so let's explain first of all how numbers work. Numbers. When you look at things like 12, 6, 331, those are all numbers in the sense that they represent a quantity. Now, the problem is what I would like to call digits. This number, 12, is made up of two digits, okay? So it's a single number. But sometimes people think of it as two separate numbers. Don't think of it that way. Think about two digits represent, symbolically represent a number. Okay, so we use, right now, we use a system called base 10, decimal. And I don't know why we use base 10, and it doesn't really matter. But no matter what base system you're using in mathematics, the base is the number of symbols that are required to make up the numbering system. Okay, so for base 10, we obviously have 10 different digits or 10 different symbols. Okay, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. 10 total. Okay, and then in order for a number to be represented, you have to understand how exponents work, powers. Okay, so base 10 means that each position in the symbolic representation of a number is the number of instances of a power of 10. So let's say that we're going to build a number that's 4 digits long. Okay, the base is 10, so I'm going to go 10 up here for each one, and I am going to go with powers. Okay, you start at 0, 1, 2, 3, and this could go on forever. You could have 10 to the billionth way out there eventually. Okay, any number to the 0 power is equal to 1. 10 to the 1 means 10 times itself once. So any number to the first power is itself. Any number to higher powers than 0 or 1, it's just the number of times you multiply it. So 10 squared is 10 times 10, or 100. 10 cubed is 10 times 10 times 10 is 1,000. Okay? So if you have some sort of random number, like let's say that we're trying to represent, 6941. 6941, really, it means 6,000, so 6 times 1,000, 900, 9 times 100, 4 times 10, 1 times 1, okay? So 6941, random number. Now, let's look at a different system. Let's say we were working with base 7, okay? So if we're working with base 7, we've got 7 symbols. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And in order to represent a number, you go 7 to the 0, 7 to the 1st, 7 to the 2nd, 7 to the 3rd, okay? So what do these numbers represent? 7 to the 0 is 1, because anything to the 0 is 1. 7 to the 1 is itself. 7 squared is 49. 7 cubed is 343. Okay, so if we have some sort of number in base 7, let's say that, let's go with an easy one. Let's go 1, 3, 6, 2. Okay, 1,362 in base 7 does not equal 1,362 as we know it in our usual base of 10. Okay, what it would mean is 1 times 343, so this is, these are the digits, or the symbols in the number. This is actually the numeric quantity, okay? So 1 times 343 is 343. 3 times 49 is 147. 6 times 7 is 42. 2 times 1 is 2. And so you add those up, and you get 534. Okay. So that's 534 in base 10, the numeric quantity that we know as 534 items can be represented as 1362 in base 7. Okay, now, base 7, not so useful. Why would anyone want to use base 7? Well, I guess if you come from a ancient civilization that had 7 moons in the sky or something like that, it might mean something, but it doesn't. Now, so why do we have base 10? Why do we have decimal? I honestly don't know. It doesn't really make sense. Signs of the zodiac, 12. You would think base 12 would be more important or something like that. Anyway, it's not important. But binary is important. Binary equals base 2. Okay? And why would you go with binary? Well, when computers were first built, calculators, they had to figure out some way for a mechanical representation of numbers. So if you're about to build a computer, you're the first computer builder in history, and you're trying to figure out, how do I do this? This is pretty complicated. If you want your machine to be able to represent numbers, it's going to be kind of complicated if every number can be represented by 10 different things. Now, the reason that's going to be complicated is because it's a lot of choices. Let's simplify. If you're using electricity and you have to be able to have 10 different numbers, 10 different digits, then the only way to do that is for your computer, your machine, to be able to understand 10 different power states, 10 different amounts of voltage, 10 different amounts of current, whatever. That's too complicated. We got to go back to simplicity. What's the simplest way to represent something with electricity? Well, electricity can be on or it can be off. So let's go with something where you only have 2 choices. That's pretty simple, okay? That's exactly why computers use binary. It's the simplest possible thing, on or off. And so when numbers are stored in computers, or anything, because all information is basically translated into symbolic numbers, okay? It's always represented by, at the very basics within the computer, by binary. Because it's electricity, or maybe it's magnetism now, whatever. Okay, but it was all based, when computers started to be built, it was based on the principle of binary because of electricity being on-off. Okay, so if you've got a base 2 system, what have you got for numbers? 2 to the 0, 2 to the 1st, 2 to the 2nd, 2 to the 3rd, 2 to the 4th, 2 to the 5th, so on. Okay? With a base 2 system, that means you have 2 symbols. What are your symbols? Well, on equals 1, off equals 0. Why did they do it that way? Why didn't they flip it around and say off equals 1 and on equals 0? I guess this makes more sense. No electricity, zero electricity, whatever, that makes sense. Okay, so if you're going to represent a number in binary, let's say that we want to figure out what this number is. We have a number that is 010110. Okay, so 2 to the 0 is equal to 1. 2 to the 1 is equal to 2, 2 squared equals 4, 2 cubed equals 8, 2 to the 4th is 16, 32. Okay, so our number in binary, 011010, to figure out what it means, 1 times 16 plus 1 times 8, nothing there, plus 1 times 2 equals 16 and 8 is 24, 26. Okay, so the number 011010 in binary equals what we know numerically as the quantity 26. Okay, so let's dig down a little bit deeper into the numbers part of binary. Okay, let's say we've got 2 to the 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Wait a minute. Let me do this a little differently. Okay. Powers of 2. To the 1st, to the 2nd, to the 3rd, to the 4th, to the 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Okay, what are these numbers? Okay, 2 to the 1st equals 2, 2 to the 2nd is 4. Going through all these quickly, 2 to the 3rd is 8. 4th is 16, 5th is 32, 6th is 64, 7th is 128, 8th is 256, 5, 12, 10, 24, 2048, 4096, 8192, 16, 384, 32, 768, and 65536. Okay? Now, let me backtrack again and give you some more background on the history of computers. When computers came out at first, they were very simple. And so these streams of ones and zeros flashing through them, streams of electricity flashing on and off, stuff like that, it had to be fairly simple. Now, when you've got a bunch of binary, let's say you've got a number like 01101011. Okay, that number equals, well, that's times 1, times 2, times 8, times 16, times 32, times 64. Whatever that number comes to, actually, I guess it doesn't really matter. The main thing is we've got to understand what these different symbols represent. In binary, each part of your number, this is your overall number, each part of your number is called a bit. Okay? So in the equivalent, say you've got a number 627234 in base 10. The number equals the overall thing. The bit in binary is the same as a digit in base 10. If you had a word, it would be the same as a letter within the word. Okay? Now, so if individual digits in binary are called bits, what's the word for an entire number? Well, it started out as being word. So they figured that any number in binary that all came at once was composed of a bunch of individual bits. That's the word. And so if you had a number that had 8 bits in it, you've got a word length of 8. Now, computers deal well with multiples of 2, and so it was common at the start, most computers were built using 4-bit words, word lengths that were only 4 bits long. So you had basically from 1 to 16 were your choices. And then for a while in the 1980s, stuff like the Commodore 64, the first Apple computers, all that sort of stuff, Ataris, they all used 8-bit word lengths. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So that's the sort of thing it was. Now 2 to the 8th is 256. So with a single word, if you're restricted to 4 bits, your word can only be one of 16 different numbers. With an 8-bit word length, it can be one of 256 different numbers. And then eventually computers got faster and faster. IBM PCs came out mid-80s, I think, and they started to use word lengths of 16 bits, okay? With a 16-bit word, you can have 65,536 different combinations, different numbers in that sort of a word length. Nowadays, computers have just recently switched from 32-bit word lengths to 64-bit word lengths. So obviously computers are getting much, much, much more complex than they were before. Now, a couple terms I'm going to throw at you. We've already said that bit is a single digit in binary. The word byte was originally meant to mean the same as a word length, okay? So the byte could be 8 bits, if you're talking about a computer that understands 8-bit addressing. If you had a more complicated computer, like a 16-bit computer, the intention was originally that byte would mean those 16 bits. But it changed. They decided to go with byte as always, always, always meaning 8 bits. Okay? Now there are other words, like if you had a 4-bit word length, they used to be called a nibble, not very commonly used nowadays. If you have, what other numbers did they use? They used octet for a while for 8-bit numbers. They used word or long for a 16-bit number. Once you got to 32 bits, there were things like, they used word again, or quad byte or double. It depends on what computer manufacturer you were talking to. They had all these different names. But anyway, when you're talking about a lot of things with computers now, you will see all these references to bits and to bytes. And essentially what it refers to is size in binary. So let's talk about bandwidth for a second. Bandwidth is the capacity to communicate information, the speed at which traffic, the speed at which information can pass through something, okay? Let's talk about the speeds of some various things, okay? Cable modem. Cable modem speeds of usually 1 to 6 megabits per second. Speed of USB 2.0, 480 megabits per second. Speed of FireWire, 400. Well, that's an easy one, 400 megabits per second. Google Fiber, the bandwidth speed of those connections is incredible. It's like 100 times faster than cable, basically. They say you can go up to 1 gigabits per second. Okay, so you'll also see references to storage capacity on hard drives. That's not per second, because that's not a bandwidth measurement or a rate measurement. That's just an absolute number. How big overall? And hard drives are usually measured in bytes. And so let's say you've got a drive that's 750 megabytes. That means, let's translate that. Hard disk drive equals 750 megabytes. Okay, you'll have to understand when you're seeing all these different references, and actually I'm going to bring one more in. I'm going to bring in MP3. MP3 at 320 kilobits per second is the rate. Okay? These are all talking about different things. These four things are the rate at which information passes through a communications medium, like a cable. This hard drive is the size. MP3 bit rate, well, that's actually related to these three things, to these four things. Same sort of thing, it's a rate. It's the speed at which information passes through. But you can see we've got all these different measurements. Okay, small b equals bit. Capital B equals byte, or 8 bits. Small k or large k both mean kilo, which is equal to 1,000. Capital M equals mega, which is equal to 1,000,000. And then if you happen to get into bigger numbers, like a bigger drive might be, that's a very small drive, sorry. Well, that's how big drives were 10 years ago. Okay, let's say you've got a 750 gigabyte drive, or even bigger, 1 terabyte drive. Okay, so giga means 1 billion. This is in the North American system. I think the British do billion differently. And then tera equals trillion. Okay, so we've got some huge number differences here. Okay, bits. Bytes. Bytes are always 8 times as big as a bit, because it's 8 bits. Prefixes, kilo, mega, giga, tera. Okay, so 1 to 6 megabits per second. Bit is 1, mega is 1,000,000, so that means 1 million to 6 million bits per second. Up to here, 480 million bits per second. Okay? 480 mega million bits per second. Knowing that there's 8 bits in a byte, can we convert 480 megabits per second into megabytes per second? Yes, just divide by 8. So these are the same number, 60 megabytes per second. And remember, bytes is big B, bit is little b, or it's actually usually spelled out nowadays, just to make sure people understand. Okay, so 60 megabytes per second, same as 480 megabits per second. Now, we come down to MP3s. These are kilo. So these are a lot slower. So 320 kilobits per second is 320,000 bits per second. We have to understand what binary numbers mean in terms of samples. Now, I talked a little bit earlier, I said sample rate, sample size. Okay, there's different words for this. Resolution, sample resolution, sample size, bit depth. All three of these things mean the same thing. And what will be given to you is a number. And it's a binary number. Now, they're not going to give you the overall number, they're going to tell you the number of bits. Okay, so if you've got a sample size of 16-bit, Do you you remember from a few minutes ago, 16 bits means that you can have a number with 16 different positions in it, a binary number with 16 different positions. And 16 different positions, if all of those symbols or digits in your binary, in your 16-bit binary number, if all those are ones, and you add it all up, well, basically, how many different numbers can you get out of a 16-bit number? It's easy. It's 2 to the 16th power. And I already said on my chart there, 2 to the 16th equals 65536. Okay? So if you have a 16-bit sample size, that means you can have 65,000 different numbers represented by that 16-bit sample size. What if you have an 8-bit number? For years in the 80s, all video games were 8-bit. Okay? Sample size of 8-bit equals 2 to the 8th equals 256. Okay, so in an 8-bit sample, you've only got 256 different options. In a 16-bit sample, you have tons more options, 65,000. Okay, 24-bit sampling is starting to come around. 2 to the 24th, huge number, 16,777,216. Okay? If you've got 16.777 million different choices with a 24-bit sample size, then you've got all kinds of options. So why is a higher sample size better? Well, it's because the higher the sample size, the more accurate your measurement is going to be. And if we want to reproduce sounds to make them sound realistic, we want accuracy in our measurements. So let's take an example. Let's say that we are trying to measure, we've got two towns, town A, town B. Distance between them, for the Americans, 10 miles. For the rest of the world, 16 kilometers. Okay? So, in our system, we have a person who is going to be walking back and forth all the time. And what we want to measure, we're looking down from a satellite, and we want to measure that person's position along this stretch. Okay, so 16 kilometers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Okay, let's say we have two different resolutions of our measuring system. The first one is 4-bit. Not very accurate. With 4-bit, how many choices do we have? Well, 2 to the 4th equals 16. Okay? So we have only 16 different possible positions, 16 different measurements that have to, they spread out and they represent all different points on our possible set of measurements. Okay? So, you know, our 16 options are basically 1, 2, sorry, I guess they should always start at 0. So our options would be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Okay? Now let's say, because we've got 16 different positions and it's 16 kilometers long, at any given point, if we try to make a measurement of where exactly our person is, how close are we going to be? Well, we could be dead on. If our person happens to be right exactly at the 8 marker, 8 kilometer marker when we make our measurement, then our measurement is actually going to be completely accurate. However, it could be that our person is exactly halfway between the 7 and 8 markers, okay? So in that case, our measurement, because we only have 16 choices, we don't have the choice of going in binary. We can't go 7.5 kilometers. We have to either round up or round down, okay? That's the way it is in binary, round up or round down. So who knows which one it'll go to. Let's say it goes to 7. It doesn't matter actually which one it goes to. In either case, the distance that we think he's at, 7 kilometers or 8 kilometers, is off by 500 meters from his true position at 7.5 kilometers. Okay? So the possible error in our 4-bit measuring system is 500 meters. Now, let's say that all of a sudden our satellite looking down, measuring where this guy is, has improved. And all of a sudden we got a big upgrade to a 24-bit system. Okay? With 24-bit, how many different numbers do we have? How many different options? We have 16,777,816. That's a lot of different options. So instead of our accuracy only being able to say he's at the 0 kilometer, he's at the 1 kilometer, he's at the 2 kilometer, etc., we have 16 million different points along here that we can measure him at. Okay? Now I'm not going to draw out 16 million different points, but the same principle will apply. No matter where he is, chances are he's not going to be measured completely accurately, because, let's see, with 16 million points along the 16 kilometer stretch, we've got about 1 centimeter of difference between each point, okay? So maybe he is 0.5 centimeter further, so our measurement system, it's still going to have to round up or round down. There's still no decimal in binary. Okay, it's going to round up or round down. But at least when it does round up or round down, the furthest inaccuracy, the furthest distance he can be from between his real point and the point that we have to measure, very worst case, is 0.5 centimeter. Okay, so 0.5 centimeter. So you can see the enormous difference in accuracy. With our 4-bit system, we can only figure out where he is to within 0.5 kilometer. With our 24-bit system, we can figure out where he is to within 0.5 centimeter. And if you want that in miles, 500 meters is, I don't know, it's 1,500 feet roughly. 0.5 centimeter is 1/8 of an inch. Okay? So, obviously, higher resolutions equals more accurate measurements. So let's use the analogy of a set of stairs next, okay? And let's compare this to volume. Let's say that we have a very, very low resolution microphone monitoring system, okay? We are able to measure sounds from 0 decibels all the way up to, let's say the loudest our microphone can measure is 120 decibels, which is about the level of a jet plane, maybe. Okay, let's say that we have a 3-bit system. So 3 bits means 2 to the 3rd equals 8 different choices. Okay, so our levels, and I'm going to draw them out like a staircase. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, if we are trying to measure our volume of some random sound which could be anywhere between 0 decibels and 120 decibels, and we're doing it with 3-bit sample size, we only have 8 different choices. So our measurements might be 0, 15, 30 decibels, 45 decibels, 60, 75, 90, 105, 120. Okay? So what happens if we have, if our sound is coming through at 97 decibels? Okay? 97, it's going to have to be rounded either up or down. It's closer to down. So our system will measure this and think that the sound is at 90 decibels, but it's not. So we've got an error. Okay? Now, what happens if all of a sudden we switch to 16-bit? Okay? 16-bit equals 65536. 65,000 different positions. So our staircase on 16-bit, instead of being 8 steps, is more like, you know, there's tons and tons of different increments. I can't draw it, obviously. But there's 65,000 different choices. Okay, so if our signal noise is 97 decibels, and we're trying to measure with 16-bit accuracy, then chances are, well, how many decibels are we going to be away from? We're probably going to be within, maybe, this is totally a guess, I don't know, maybe within 0.0013 decibels, okay? If we're making a mistake in our measurement of the volume of the sound, we would far rather be off by 0.0013 decibels, or whatever this is, than to be off by 7 decibels. So you can see why increasing the resolution of your sample size makes the accuracy better, which makes it a more realistic interpretation of what's really going on. Now, what if you had actually, I could have probably left those there. What if I was going with, let's say I've recorded something, a sound, and it's a sound where I'll go with pitch instead of volume, okay? Let's say my pitch is dropping over time, so it's going, and so on. Okay, if I have a low resolution system, as my pitch drops, it's going to have to go in staircase levels. It's going to go, okay? If you're trying to listen to that, and you know that the sound really is doing a smooth, and instead you're hearing, okay, that's not, that sounds ridiculous, I know. That's obviously not a very good representation of what's really happening. But if you have higher sample resolution, that means your stairs are not going to be so jagged. It's going to be more like a lot of little, it's going to be a lot smoother curve down, okay? So the higher the resolution, the more different options you have in each measurement, the more accurate, because I don't know how else I can explain it. It's just, it's better. Higher resolution, much better. And it's exponential. It's not a case where 24-bit compared to 16, you can't just say, well, 24-bit must be 50% better. 50% of 16 is 8. So a 50% improvement from 16 gives you 24-bit. That's not how it works. The difference is 16777216 divided by 65536. That number, if you divide it out, is 256. 2 to the 8th. Makes sense, okay? So, when you switch from 16-bit accuracy to 24-bit accuracy, you're not getting 50% more accurate. You're getting 256 times as accurate. Crazy. Okay, now, does that mean that your files on the hard drive are taking up 250 times as much room? No, that's the beauty of it. Your storage size has increased by 50%. Okay, so for every single sample you take, instead of 16 ones and zeros in one sample, instead you have 24. Okay, so you do take up 50% more space by jumping from 16-bit to 24-bit. But even though it's only a 50% jump in size requirements, it's 256 times as accurate. Okay? So obviously, higher sample sizes are better. Now, as far as sample sizes go, what is the standard nowadays? CD quality has been a certain standard since the 80s when they came out, and that is that they are 16-bit, 44.1 kilohertz. Okay, we'll get to the frequency in a second. But as far as the 16-bit, that's been standard for years. Okay, if you go into a studio nowadays, it's very common for you to see the option of 24-bit recording. Would you want to do that on a project you're working on? I would say yes. If you have the space available on your computer, try to work with the highest possible bit depth, sample size. Okay? 24 is common, much better than 16. Okay? 16, CD quality, why stop there if you can go with better quality? Now, it's possible to jump ahead to higher numbers even than 24-bit, okay? I have seen 48-bit sample sizes in some high-end studios. Okay, for home projects, don't worry about that. I have also seen, actually most computer software nowadays has the option to go with 32-bit. So would it make sense to jump to 32? Well, that's an odd number for a weird reason, okay? To try and simplify this, 32-bit is usually floating point. It's a different type of binary. And basically what it is, it's kind of like 24 plus decimal points, okay? That's not completely accurate, but I'm trying to give you an analogy, okay? So when your resolution is already that fine, do you really need the extra tiny, tiny fraction? Because what's going to happen is those decimal points are rounded off, so you just lose them anyway, okay? So technically speaking, I would say the layman's easy way of looking at it is that those extra 8 bits don't really give you anything because they're chopped off. However, they still add to the amount of storage space you need on the disk, okay? So I would not go with 32-bit as your project setting. It doesn't make sense to me. Does it make sense eventually? Yes. Maybe not in the recording process when you're saving stuff on the disk. Go with 24 or 16 if you've got a less versatile system. You might want to jump up to 32 if you're doing fancy signal processing, if you're doing a lot of effects and stuff like that, okay? But we'll get into that in later sessions, okay? For now, my recommendation is either go with 16, simple, CD quality. It's not going to be bad quality. It's what the world's listened to for years. Or, if your system's capable, 24 is even better. Now, let's talk about frequency. Frequency is the number of times per unit of time something is measured, okay? Frequency is usually expressed in hertz. Hertz was a German scientist. He did all these studies on frequency, so they've named the unit of frequency after him. And it's used in a whole bunch of different fields. It's not just frequency of sounds, it's frequency of electrical stuff, it's all kinds of different things that have to be measured in iterations per period of time. Okay, so hertz specifically means cycles or repetitions per second. Okay, so hertz, well, what can be measured with frequency? There's different things. There's things that are cyclical, so things like a sine wave that goes up and down in a cycle, that's cyclical. There can be things like rotary things, like something that goes around, that is cyclical, like a clock hand. You can have things like waves on an ocean, they're cyclical as they pass a certain point. Or you can also have periodic, and that's instances. So maybe you've got something, a water drop. Okay, the tap's dripping, that's a periodic thing instead of a cyclical. Either way, they're all measured, they can all be measured in hertz, in cycles or repetitions per second. Okay, now, how often is stuff usually measured per second? Well, the more often the better. If you had, let's say that I am playing the piano, I'm playing scales, and I'm bouncing around, I'm going pretty fast, and I'm playing a scale every second. So it's da-da-da-da-da-da-da, 8 notes every second. And I just keep doing that over and over again. If your sample rate is 1 hertz, then that is 1 time per second. If I'm playing 8 notes per second, and you're only taking a sample once, then you're missing a lot of notes. You have no idea what I'm doing in between, like every time you sample one note, you don't realize, but I'm playing 7 more in between. So the accuracy of your recording of me is pretty bad. Now, what if you go with a faster frequency? If you go with 8 hertz, so you're sampling 8 times a second, then all of a sudden you're actually catching every note. Okay? So obviously, faster measurements, better. Now, how often is good enough? Well, in CD quality, that same standard we were talking about where our bit depth is 16 bits, 44.1 kilohertz. 44.1 kilohertz is the CD standard. And that means 44,100 hertz, okay? So sound on a CD is sampled at 44,100 times per second. That's pretty fast. So CDs were recorded, always are recorded at 44.1 kilohertz for the sampling frequency. But why? Why that number? Why 44.1? It seems like a really odd number. Why not use some sort of round number like 40,000 or 50,000? Well, I think it relates to this. Remember earlier in the video I mentioned the Nyquist theorem? And the Nyquist theorem states that in order to get a good quality reproduction of any audio that you're recording, your sample frequency has to be at least double the frequency of the audio. Now, if you recall, for human hearing, most humans can hear stuff in the range from 20,000 hertz to, or from 20 hertz to 20,000 hertz, or 20 kilohertz. Okay, so within that range, obviously the low frequencies aren't going to be a problem, because if you have a low sample rate, you'll easily be able to do a recording of the low frequencies that'll sound good. It's the ones at the high end that are the problem. So knowing that the Nyquist theorem says you have to go with double the rate, the frequency of the sound you're recording, for those high sounds in your music, you're going to need to go double 20,000, which means you're going to need to go at 40,000 hertz in order to record and have it sound good. So why are CDs at a standard of 44.1 instead of 40,000? This seems like such a much more convenient number. Well, there's a couple different reasons I've heard. All of them kind of make a little bit of sense. First of all, when you're working with a high pass filter or a low pass filter, remember how your curves on either side are not straight. It's not like a cliff. Like if you've got a high cut filter or a low pass filter, then you can't go up and then all of a sudden at a point nothing gets by. So all the signal in the low frequencies gets by, all the signals in the high frequencies doesn't. That's not the way it works. The way it works is it rolls off. Okay? And the roll off can have different slopes. It can have a narrow roll off, or it can have a steep roll off, but it can't have a vertical cliff. Okay? So I think basically what's happened is one option is that if you start rolling stuff off at your 20,000 hertz, some of it at 20,000 hertz, some of the stuff above 20,000 hertz is still getting through. You know, small volumes, but whatever. So in order to account for those frequencies above 20 that still might not be heard by almost anyone, maybe they bumped it up. Maybe it's just some cushion room on the high end. Now, another theory I've heard, which also makes sense, is that in the early days, when CDs first came out, they were really constrained on equipment. The technology wasn't there to make this all easy like it is today. And I believe that some of the equipment that they commonly use to do CD masters, some of the technical specifications of that equipment made it just logical to use 44.1 kilohertz as a rate. Anyway, whatever the reason is, that's what they picked as a standard back then, and that still exists today. So what sample rates are available out there? Well, I've already said 16 bits sample size and 44.1 sample frequency. Sample rate is the standard for CDs. Always has been, always will be. That's the way they built it. If you're talking about DVDs, well, you can have 16-bit with 48 kilohertz. Okay, now that is actually for DVD, I call it DVD-V, and it stands for DVD video. So on a video DVD, the audio soundtrack that goes along with it is 16-bit 48 kilohertz. Now there's a second DVD standard, and that is 2496. And obviously that's a lot better than this. And that's used for the DVD-A. The DVD-A specification, which is a higher quality audio CD. Okay? So the what's the best one? Well, obviously the highest quality is the best, so 2496. Now what's common in studios today? I would say, in my experience, studio work, same thing. 2496 is very common. And it's good. I mean, you think about CDs, how good CD quality is. People have been listening to those for years and years. You know, if you can improve on that, then you're obviously going to have a good quality product. Now, are there higher rates available? Yes. I have seen studios, very high-end studios, professionals, where they'll go 48 bit depth for sample size and 192 kilohertz for frequency. That I think that's a little bit of overkill. I think that's a little excessive. But if they can afford the equipment and the storage space and everything, then so be it. What do I use personally, or what do I recommend? Well, for most of my quick, easy projects that I'm going to be sharing on the internet And for things I recommend with any amateur home recording situation, I would go with 1644. Okay. Now, do I use higher rates? Yes. Occasionally, I'll use 2496. But the problem with that is at the end, well, first of all, it takes up more space because the jump from 16-bit to 24-bit takes up 50% more space, and the jump from 44 to 96 takes up more than double the space, like 2.2 times as much, roughly. So between that going up 50% and this going up, basically your project at this setting is 3.5 times almost as big as it is at this setting. So if you have lots of hard drive space, sure, whatever. Is it worth it all the while? No, because a lot of projects that I do that just need something quick and easy, they don't have to be at that high quality. So why bother going to that step if you can just go with something that's going to sound great to the average person? Okay. The other thing is, too, if you go with this higher rate, if it's going to go onto a CD eventually, you have to downsample and bring it back to this setting anyway. And that's a problem that a lot of people don't realize. I've seen all sorts of people that have produced a project at a higher rate, like 16, 24, 48 or something like that. They output their final bounced master file and they burn it to a CD. They're all excited. They go to listen to it and it doesn't work. And why? It's because your project absolutely must be at those settings for it to work on CD. So if you record, and you know, this burns people sometimes because they'll do it like 16 and 48, they'll turn it into an MP3 and they'll put it out on the internet, and certainly anyone who's listening on the internet, on a player like a like Real Player, Windows Media Player, Winamp, any of those old things, if they're listening to that, sure, all that software will play. So people, you know, they're able to listen to the song, but then they go to burn it onto a CD and it doesn't work. And so your listeners out there are getting frustrated because they can't burn your music to CD. And you may not even realize, because you're not even thinking about the fact that when they burn it to a CD, it's not working, because they don't tell you, they don't assume it's your fault. They're trying to figure out why the music didn't burn on the CD. Anyway, it's a mess. So if you're distributing stuff that might get burned onto CD, stick with that. I mean, some CD burning software will do the conversions automatically for you, so it takes care of the problem, but you can't count on that. Okay, so I think that's my takeaway lesson, is this is not a bad idea, especially for the audience that I'm talking to right now, mostly home or semi-pro users. This is not a bad setting. If you can get away with this high setting, if you have the equipment and whatnot, use it, but you'll still have to output like this if you're going to have a product that might be used on CD. Okay, one last quick thing I want to tell you that's useful for practical purposes. Let's say we're working with stereo audio, 16-bit, 44.1 kilohertz. Okay, how much space does that take? For every minute of audio, we're looking at 10 megabytes of space, okay? Knowing how all this stuff works, you can figure out your space requirements for a project, okay? So let's say, okay, first of all, stereo is the same as two mono tracks, okay? So if this were to change to mono instead of stereo, we'd be looking at 5 megabytes per minute. This is all per minute of music, okay? Let's say that we have a project where we have 10 tracks total, okay? We have a drum kit with 4 microphones on it, all mono. Okay, so drums, 4. We have a keyboard, which is stereo, with 2. We have a guitar, which is mono, with 1. We have a bass, mono, with 1. And we have 2 vocals. Okay, so we have a total of, 10 tracks, mono, or 5 stereo tracks. Okay, So that means 10 mono tracks instead of 2 mono tracks means we're looking at 50 megabytes per minute with 10 mono. Okay, if you shift up, okay, let's figure out how long the song is too. Let's say we're doing an epic track, Bohemian Rhapsody sort of thing, and it's 6 minutes long. Okay, so 6 minutes long at 50 megs per minute. So right now we're looking at a project size of 300 megabytes on your disk, roughly. Okay, let's switch from 16 to 24-bit. You go to 24-bit, and then your space requirement goes up by 50%, so all of a sudden you need 450 megabytes. Okay, let's say that we jump up to 48 kilohertz sample frequency. Okay, so that's an increase of about 10%, so all of a sudden we're looking at about 500 megs. Okay, and I would add for contingency, because you always take up more space than you expect, add 50%, so 750 megabytes. Okay, and actually, let's be realistic. Each of these tracks we're not going to record one copy of. We're going to multi-track, we're going to do 4 takes of every single instrument, just to be safe, because we're going to take each of their 4 tracks, cut and paste, split them up, and make one beautiful, perfect, comped track out of it. Compiled, completed track. I don't know what it even stands for, but comping, that's what it is. So we actually have 4 times as many tracks as we thought before. So 750 times 4 equals 3,000 megabytes, or 3 gigabytes. Okay? So by knowing these numbers, I mean, really, you know how all the different bit rates work. So the only thing you have to memorize is stereo at CD quality. Stereo is 10 megs per minute. Okay? Wipe everything out and just think 10 megs per minute for stereo, and you can figure out everything else from there. Okay, so that's all I'm going to show you for today. By now, you should understand sampling rates and sampling frequency in quite a bit of depth, certainly more depth than a lot of people out there. And I'll do another video later on, which gets into like the dithering and the anti-aliasing and stuff like that. You know, stuff that's directly related to your sample rate and frequency, but a little bit more advanced. But you don't need to know that right now. Our next video, let's move back into some hands-on stuff. We'll do a video about working with MIDI, and we'll just go from there. Okay? So thanks for watching, and like I say, djbolivia/videos if you're looking for links to some of the other tutorial videos I have online. Thanks.